I believe it is a message that is necessary to be heard. It better be that, or I'm wasting my time. But it is a message that I believe is a timely message, maybe for where we're at in the world today and the situations in the world today, and something that I believe that we need to be reminded of. I believe the Lord put it on my heart, maybe for a specific reason, something that we need to be reminded of who we are, where we're going. It's not an accident that we're here today. I think we look at life sometimes a little haphazard, and I don't believe that it is that way. The title of the message the Lord has given to me is Lift Up the Hands. Lift up the hands. And somehow, I don't know whether to say, is it a modern gospel that is being preached? But there's an idea that is prevalent, at least in some places and in some people's minds, that somehow when we become a Christian and open our hearts, we repent, we become part of the kingdom of God, that somehow our lives as Christians should be a life that now is without trouble. I've not found it that way. And in fact, if you study the Word of God and you read what the Bible says, you'll find that the Bible does not say that. The Bible speaks about the blessing of Abraham that we can walk in, which is the Spirit. Talks about the abundance of grace. Talks about the care that God gives us as a father. But it also speaks that a Christian will go through things that are difficult. And we face things in life that are perplexing at times. Paul spoke of this, of things that he went through. And he said there's times that he faced things that he was perplexed. He was perplexed. He didn't understand why he was going through the things that he was going through. He faced times that he was pressed, even it says, that were beyond measure. He couldn't measure how he was pressed. Those are times that Paul went through. And in reading of men of faith, you'll read that there were things that they faced that they didn't understand. That's part of what my message is today. How do we deal with disappointments? Because disappointments come. We are people who dream at times of the things that we'd like to have in life, of the way that we'd like things to go. I do. I have plans. I have goals. I have things that I want to see happen in business, in family, spiritually, in my life. But you know, those plans don't always work out the way that I'd like for them to work out. And I can guarantee you that you face the same things that I do. Things that I wonder, why did this happen? And I don't always have an answer for that, and I don't have an answer for you today and all of the reasons of why that all happens. So this is a wrong idea that a Christian will never face difficult times. And in fact, I have found that when the Lord found me and I found the Lord and I received His grace through Jesus Christ, that there was a turning in my life, and where no longer was I floating down the stream of life, now I had turned and set my face towards Zion to go a path that most of the world and most of humanity is not walking on. Most of humanity is walking down a path that's very wide, it's very broad, and the way into it is very easy. But you and I, as Christians, as believers in Yeshua, have chosen to walk through a gate that the Bible says is straight, and it's narrow, and the way that we walk on is a straight and a narrow road. Don't be fooled. Don't be fooled. There's a lot of people on the wide road and on the broad road. There's many, many people that go in thereat, but there's very few that find the road that is straight and the road that is narrow. Don't be fooled. Don't be fooled. This is the truth of God's word. How do we deal with disappointments? They'll come. What mindset should we have? What mindset should we have when we face these difficult things? How should we face these things? You see, if our thinking is wrong, the Bible speaks of what's in the heart, what's in the mind. You see, if our thinking is wrong and our understanding is wrong, we will become discouraged. But if we allow the Word of God to instruct us and our minds and our hearts to be instructed in what the Bible teaches us, it will change the way that we face things and that we understand things. So this is a wrong idea. Again, if I can go back to that, this is a wrong idea that a Christian will never face difficult times. Oh no, we'll face difficult times. Times of perplexity, as I've already said. And I want to look at some things. I want to look at some people, some men of faith who've gone through some things as we go through this. We face trouble. I have four categories here. We face trouble because I believe of about four categories, if I can refine it down to that. And if I can, just before I go on here, touch on that. We face trouble because we live in a fallen world. We live in a world that's been impacted because two human beings lived in a garden at one time. And they made a choice to take of something that God instructed of them not to take. And because of that, sin entered into the world, as we very well know. And it has impacted us. Even creation itself, it says, groans under the burden of sin and corruption, waiting until the day of the final redemption and the sons of God are revealed. There's a groaning that goes on, even in the very creation itself. And I believe in our own spirits at times, but we live in a world that is fallen, in a world that is corrupt. That's why there's sickness. That's why things don't always go right. That's why you get up on Monday morning and you go and you sweat and you live by the sweat of your brow, because our way back mother and father, Adam and Eve, made a choice to go away from God's word. Jesus came to restore everything that was lost. That's one of the reasons that we face trouble. Jesus said, in this world, you'll have trouble. So don't be surprised when you face trouble in this world. There's going to be that. Just in the common course of life, there's trouble. Things give out. Things deteriorate. That's normal living, okay? So that's one reason. Another reason is sowing and reaping. We face trouble because of sowing and reaping. Don't be surprised if today, after we're done here, and you get on the road, and you head towards home or wherever you're going, there's these little signs that are posted beside the road instructing us on the speed that we should drive. Don't be surprised if you ignore that sign and you decide instead of 55 that you're going to drive 95, Don't be surprised if you reap the results of your decision. If you do that long enough, it's going to cost you. I found that out as a young man. I ignored it for a while, and it caught up with me. That's sowing and reaping. Now that goes into spiritual things also, but I'm just making an illustration here. Don't be surprised in life if you do certain things that are against the principles of God, that you reap the results of that in your life, and you'll experience trouble. Another reason that sometimes, and I say trouble, I'm talking about things that don't go the way that we'd like for them to go. Another reason that we do is because God loves us. He cares for us. He's a father to us. And because of that tremendous love that He has, He sees that there's elements in us at times. And He understands that He needs to bring a chastening on us at times. And He needs to bring His hand on us in certain ways and bring things to pass in our life that bring us into places where the things, those elements of life, need to be brought out of us, that more of His holiness and more of His perfection can come forth from us. It's chastening. And then there's another reason sometimes that we face trouble. And it's because we've chosen to walk with God in paths of righteousness. Because we do right, there's times that we face trouble. Job was one of those men. Job was a man that lived right before God. And as you know the story, I'm not going to go into that, but as you know the story, Job was a man that, I'll touch on it a little bit, but one day it says the sons of God came before God, and also there was Satan the enemy. And God said, "Have you looked at Job? Have you considered him? Have you seen the way that he lives? Think of that. A man that lived right to such an extent that God pointed him out and said, have you looked at Job? Have you seen him? Look at the example of a man of faith." And the enemy said, "Oh yeah, he just does that because you give him things." And God allowed the enemy to touch him. Job didn't understand what was going on, but God allowed the enemy to touch him, take things away from him to the point that only his life was left. And yet Job, the faith that was in him, remained firm. Oh, he questioned things and he was perplexed, but his faith remained firm. It's one of the other reasons when you and I allow the work of God to go on in us. And history is full of people who have been persecuted, who have lost their lives because they believed in God, because they had faith. Today in America, at least at this point, we don't know persecution like that. We don't know what the future will hold, because the Bible tells us that they that live godly in Christ Jesus, they will suffer persecution. Maybe we don't suffer physical persecution sometimes in other ways. Well, those are reasons. Now I want to look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 5 and 7. And this is, you know, some of these things that I'm preaching about today, they are familiar. They're not maybe new things, but things that we need to be reminded of. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 5 through 7 says like this here. It says, "We are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. wherein ye greatly rejoice. We rejoice in the salvation that is going to be revealed in the last time. We rejoice in the salvation that God has brought to us through Jesus Christ. That means we jump for joy. Today during the worship, I blessed me as men came walking up through here. I don't know if any of them jumped. I felt like jumping. Maybe we need to jump sometimes. That's what this word means here. We greatly rejoice. We jump because of the joy of salvation. Because it's the reality of what Jesus has done. Maybe today you sit here and maybe you're somewhat discouraged because of situations you face in life. I know what that is. Maybe you're discouraged because you see things in your own life that you're discouraged with. I know what that is too. I know when we face things and we wonder, will I ever overcome this? Will this always be a struggle in my life? But one of the reasons we have joy is because we know that the work of Jesus Christ is a finished work. And our salvation rests on Him, not on us. That's what this is speaking about. That's why we can have joy. And if you're looking for joy by looking for things in the world and circumstances, you're going to be mightily disappointed. If you can only have joy when things go right for you, when your plans go right, and your dreams are all fulfilled, if that's the only time you can have joy, then it's not the true joy that the Holy Ghost brings. The true joy of God is not, it's not based on happenings and when things go right, but on the truth and the reality of the finished work of Jesus Christ. That's what this is saying here. Oh, we're kept by the power of God by faith, through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Wherein ye greatly rejoice in that salvation. Then it goes on to say, though now for a season. I want to talk about seasons a little bit, because the Bible talks about seasons and we have seasons. And it says, now for a season, if need be or if necessary, you're in heaviness. Now, isn't that interesting that in the same verse, verse 6, it says, we greatly rejoice, we jump for joy, but then there's seasons and times when, if it's necessary, there's some kind of heaviness sometimes that comes upon us and a weight of things, and it's just heavy, and it's hard to jump in those times. But it's necessary that we go through some of those things. And it says through manifold or many, the King James says temptations. I believe, after looking at this, I believe a better word, or the way that the Hebrew or the Greek would be translated into, would be many trials. Because temptations gives the idea of temptation to sin, which that it can be a trial. But it's really talking about many trials that a Christian will face, that it's necessary at times, and that there's seasons that we go through. When we experience these things, there's seasons. And I've noticed this in my own life, and I've noticed it in the course of life, that there's seasons. And obviously, we also notice that in just in nature and in the course, we're in the season of summer right now. I love summer. My family knows I love summer. I love spring. And I love fall. Summer's my favorite season. Winter, I endure. Quite honestly, I know that God gave us all four of those seasons and that they're all necessary. Maybe that's the time of heaviness. They're all necessary, at least for where we live here. And they're seasons. And it brings variety into our life. Those are the seasons that we go through. And each season, even though I said what I did about winter, each season has its beauty. Each season has its place. Spring, when life is springing forth. Farmers are plowing the fields, and the green is coming. And you have the hope after the winter that there will again be warmth and sunshine, and the things spring forth. And then the summer, when things continue to grow and it's warm, and then fall, when it's such a bountiful time of harvest, and you begin to see the results of what were done in the spring. But then comes winter, when it seems everything becomes ineffective and dead and cold. And like I said, you endure. Winter has its own beauty. If nothing else, it makes us appreciate the other seasons. The seasons, and I've noticed this in my own life, that we go through seasons where seemingly it seems like things go so right, and there's harvest, and there's productivity, and it seems like everything we do is effective, and it's easy to rejoice and to jump for joy. And then maybe something happens, or sometimes we don't know why. It seems something changes, and there's a heaviness. And it's a time of enduring. We go through that. We should not be surprised at that. It's necessary. There's wonderful things that happen in the time of death. Maybe you're there. And sometimes in that time of death, it seems like it's so hopeless. The days are dark, and not much seems to be going on. But I'll tell you, in those times, there's a preparation for a greater harvest and a greater life. Think of Jesus. He had seasons. The Bible says that in the fullness of time, I don't understand all of that, but there's a fullness of time when God said, now is the time. It's full. It's the time to bring the Savior on the scene. And Jesus entered into this world as a baby, had a season of growing. It says there was a season where he grew in favor with God and man, and came to a place where that passed off the scene. And then he had the season of 3 years of when he ministered, and he began to walk in miracles. And people began to see the power of God manifested like they'd never seen it before. And seemingly, in a moment, when those that were close around him could have looked at that and said, oh, he's in the prime of his ministry. He's in the prime of his miracles. He's in the prime. Look at what's happening. People are being changed. The gospel's being preached. People are being healed. And in that, it changed. And he went to a cross. And to the human eye, and certainly to the disciples, it must have appeared like all of our hopes have been dashed. They went fishing. And I honestly believe, even though Jesus had told them what he must go through, they were dull yet. They didn't have the Holy Spirit, or the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And they didn't understand, and their hopes were dashed. And all that they had pinned their ideas on and their hopes on was now gone, and Jesus was dead in a tomb. And the season that had been was now gone. And it was a time of death. But Jesus didn't stay in that tomb, friends. That was only a season. It was only for a time. But it was necessary, and if he wouldn't have gone in that season and in that tomb and laid down and went to that cross, you and I would not know salvation today. Maybe there would be stories written of a man who came and lived and did mighty miracles. But if he would not have gone, and as it says, Jesus said, a seed has to fall into the ground. It's got to go down in there and deteriorate so that the life that's in there can come out. Amen. And that life has burst forth through the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And today you and I have that life in us. If you've been born again, if you've received him, that life is in us. The life that's eternal. The life that springs forth. The life that can go through a season when it's perplexed. The life that can go through a season when it's dark and dry. And at the end of that season, by the power of God, because it's a faith that's a mustard seed faith, that seed, even though it seems like things have deteriorated and fallen away, there comes the blade, there comes the green. When you thought, I might never be able to really stand up and rejoice again. Because it's not your life or mine. It's the resurrection life of Jesus. Because he went into a tomb, because he went onto a cross, and his disciples, I believe they were shattered. I believe they were shattered. All that they had thought would happen was shattered. But Jesus got up again. Seasons. Sometimes it's necessary that for a season you go through things that are heavy. It works a wonderful work in that time. We think certain seasons are to be avoided and that it would be better if it was always springtime or always summer or maybe always fall. But each season works what needs to be worked in our lives. It says, through many trials. What is a trial? What is a trial? I have here in my hand something that is precious, at least by the world's standards. It's very precious. It's a gold coin. It's a gold coin. It's a 1904 Liberty Double Eagle. I'm not sure, it's probably close to 1 ounce or maybe 1 ounce of gold. This coin is 99.99% pure gold. It's about as pure as you can make gold, at least by human standards. And if this coin could speak, which it can't, but if it could, it could tell you of quite a process that it went through to become what it is here today in my hand. It took approximately between 80 and 100 tons of rock to produce about an ounce of gold. Between 80 to 100 tons. That's a few truckloads. That rock has to be crushed, going through a crushing process, and then out of that, I'm not sure what all procedure, there's some different procedures today that they do, but once they have brought it down and refined it down somewhat to what gold, to where it's primarily gold, there's still a lot of process that it has to go through to end up where it is here today. It's called the smelting process, and what they do, and this is ages old that they have done this, and they take that ore where this precious metal is found, and they put it in a vessel. They used to put it long ago into clay pots, and they begin to heat it up, and they put fire under it, And they heat that. And if that ore could speak, it would probably say, "What is all this heat?" And as that fire begins to burn, gold melts at around 1940 degrees Fahrenheit, something like that, very close. And the fire gets turned up. There's a certain point where, as that fire is turned up, all the strength, all the form of what that gold has, suddenly, if you've ever watched something melt, if you ever watched lead melt, it looks so solid and it looks so strong until the heat gets turned on to it, and then suddenly, at a certain point, it just, boom, it collapses. That's what this gold does. It collapses, and that heat is on that, and they continue to put heat onto it. But as that heat and as that gold collapses and forms itself to the vessel that it is in, out of that gold begins to come the impurities that you could not see before the heat was applied. But as that heat is applied, the impurities that keep this from being 99.999% pure begin to come to the surface. And they take a skimmer and they skim that gold, that dross, they call it, and they begin to skim it off. They skim it off. Now, the interesting thing is, as they do that, and they do that numerous times, I'm not sure how many times, but numerous times that this gold has to go through that process to get it to the point where it is 99.9%. It's not just one time, but numerous times. They melt it, let it cool off, and then they melt it again, and then more comes out of it, and they take it out. This is the refining process. This gold is being tried. It's a trial. It's being tried to see what is in it, what comes out of it. It starts out originally as maybe 80 or 100 tons of rock. It gets refined down to maybe several ounces. And then it gets refined down further and further and further, until just small amounts begin to come out of it. I'll tell you that this is the refining process that God works in our life, in yours and mine. It says it's the trying of our faith. It's the trying of our faith. Many years I thought that it says it's the trying of us, and it is the trying of us, but it's the trying of our faith. And I'll tell you, this is the reality of it. You and I, we have experiences. God does things in our life, and they're precious. He works His work in us. He puts His life into us. But sometimes it's mixed with our own ideas, our own strength. Even sometimes things that we think might be faith, but it's really our own things. And the fire of trial gets put onto it. It's necessary. It's good. And out of that fiery trial suddenly comes to the surface things that you and I didn't realize that were in our lives. We thought we were further than that. That's right. And in those moments, you and I have a choice. Because the truth is that a lot of times there's other people involved in these trials. Maybe not always, but a lot of times there are. And you and I, in those moments, we have a choice to submit, or we can begin to point fingers and we can begin to blame other people for the trial that we're going through. And later on, we'll see some things that the Bible says about the truth of who we are in the hand of God. And it sometimes seems that all we thought we had, the form we had, the strength we had, suddenly seems to melt down, and our strength seems to be gone. And the very things that we thought we knew and had, we're not sure where they're at. This is reality. It's real. But it's a process that we need to go through. And it says then, if we would go on reading, that is found, here it is, I have the verse here, it's verse 7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. It's the purifying of our faith. Because you see, this starts out as a large amount, but it's not worth much. It's rock. Some gold mixed in it. And it gets diminished and diminished and diminished and diminished and diminished and diminished. I don't know what the ratio would be if you would begin to count, but it gets diminished and diminished and diminished. And it could say, what are you doing to me? I'm a lot less than I used to be. I thought I was more than that. But when it ends up, the value is tremendous. This was trapped in rock and process and crushing and heat brought it to the value that it is today. This is nothing. This is nothing compared to the faith that is in you and being worked in you. That's the reality. People kill for this. People kill for this. Hear me. This is nothing . Would I give this for my faith? Would you give your faith for this? Can this save your soul? And men spend their lives grasping, stealing, murdering, giving their health for this. This is nothing. This is nothing. The faith that is in you, that God is purifying, is precious beyond words. It's to the saving of your soul. Don't despise when God comes to purify as the refiner of silver and gold. This is a work. Don't despise it. It's by far more precious than any gold that this will perish. And it will be found. It's tremendous. It will be found unto the praise and the honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, because it's His work and it's even His faith. Maybe you're going through that refining process. Maybe you're saying, the things I thought I had, I don't even know that I have them anymore. It's not a time to blame other people. It's a time to say, Lord, You work Your work in me. I don't like what I see. You work Your work in me. The trying of our faith. What is strength? Because the gold, you see, loses its strength. We look for strength in a lot of ways. And I don't know how many of you have been to conventions. I know some of you have. I go to a flooring convention. been to different conventions. And sometimes they have speakers there, motivational speakers. I just read about one. It was well known. I'm not going to even mention his name, but he had a group of people, and some of them got hurt because he was trying to teach them to walk across hot coals of fire. And they're motivational speakers, and they try to teach you how to self-improve yourself and to make yourself better. And I've sat in those motivational classes. I believe some of the rest of you have also. You know, they could get you all pumped up to the point where you say, you know what? I'm going to go out and I'm just going to do it. And your emotions get all up. Lasts about so long. It's just self-effort. That's just self-effort. Lasts about so long. That's very tiring. People look for strength in those ways of self-improvement. They look for ways to dominate and to feel like they're in control. And they build up their self-confidence, or they try to, or they build up their bodies with different things that they do. But the Bible says that to depend on the flesh is foolish. And it is. It's very foolish. I want to read, if you want to turn with me, to Psalm 84. I'm going to read this entire chapter, which is 12 verses long. And then I want to talk a little bit about David. David, the man that God said, he's a man after my own heart. David, whom Jesus has said is the son of David, a tremendous man of faith. So I want to read this chapter, Psalm 84, starting in verse 1. How amiable are thy tabernacles, O Lord of hosts! My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh crieth out for the living God. Yea, the sparrow hath found a house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young, even thine altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. They will be still praising thee. Selah. Blessed is the man whose strength is in thee, in whose hearts are the ways of them, who passing through the valley of Baca, make it a well. The rain also filleth the pools. They go from strength to strength, every one of them in Zion appearing before God. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob, Selah. Behold, O God, our shield, and look upon the face of thine anointed. For a day in thy courts is better than 1,000. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield, and the Lord will give grace and glory, and no good thing will we withhold from them that walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man that trusteth in thee. This is a wonderful psalm, a psalm that I've gone back to numerous times in my life. I want to talk a little bit about the condition or where David was at when he wrote this psalm. We know that David had, we think when we talk of David, one of the first things we think about is we think of Goliath and David slaying the giant. And there's a wonderful, wonderful event. And we think of him as a shepherd boy when God taught him to depend on him for the lion and the bear and for the caring of sheep. But David also had things in his life that sometimes we don't often talk about. One of them was Bathsheba. That happened before this psalm was written. And what happened there and how he sinned. And how he fell into adultery and then into murder, which is quite something when you think about it, that this was a man that was then called the man after God's own heart. But it was after that that I want to build a little bit of a foundation here and tell you about David's life and where he was at when he wrote this psalm. David had a daughter with one of his wives who was called Tamar. Tamar was a beautiful girl. Very beautiful, the Bible says, to look upon. David had a son who was a half-brother to Tamar. His name was Amnon. Amnon saw Tamar. The Bible says that he was so smitten with her beauty, that he quit eating and he laid around and he was, I guess you'd say, lovesick. He was so smitten with Tamar. One of his friends, I think it was Jonadab was his name, asked him, "What's wrong?" And Amnon said, "Well, this is what's going on." Jonadab came up with a plan. He said, "Well, act like you're sick and have your sister come in and take care of you. And then tell her." And so he did this. And tried to seduce his sister Tamar, or his half-sister. And she said, "No, no, this is wrong." And it ended up that this young man, Amnon, violated his sister and raped her. And then he hated her and wouldn't marry her, which I'm not sure how that, I don't know, it's a little, don't understand all those things back there. But anyway, David had another son and his name was Absalom. Absalom hated Amnon because of that, because of what he had done, because Tamar was Absalom's sister. Some years later, Absalom planned and he laid in wait. And some years later, he called a feast. He said, "David, I want to have a feast for all your sons." And all the sons came together, and Amnon was among them. And Absalom planned this very carefully. He was a crafty man. And in that feast, suddenly, he rose up and he killed Amnon. And then he fled because David was angry with Absalom. And so Absalom fled over to another country and he lived there for several years because David would not allow him back into the kingdom. It's a lot of drama that went on. Finally, one of David's advisors said, "David, why don't you let Absalom come back? He's your son." And David's heart longed for Absalom, even though he had banished him. David's heart longed for Absalom, so he allowed Absalom to come back. Well, Absalom hadn't changed much. He was very crafty. And it says, the Bible says that he was at the gate of the city, and there at the gate of the city, as people would come in, he would ask them, because they would come in to receive counsel or to receive judgment for things that went wrong in their life, and then he'd talk to them, and he'd say, "Well, what's your problem?" And they'd say, "Well, so-and-so happened, and we don't know what to do." And then Absalom would say, "Well, yeah, we don't really have anyone to represent your part of the kingdom. But if I was king," very crafty, "I was king, I would make so that your problem's taken care of." And gradually, Absalom built himself up a following of people and raised himself an army till one day he had an army of people. And he came in blowing trumpets. And David's advisors said, "Absalom is coming with a large group of people, and he's here to overthrow your kingdom, to overthrow your kingdom." And David and his advisors and his, you'd call them his staff, I guess, they left and they fled because Absalom was coming to take his life. And it looked like he would overthrow him. One of the things that David did when this happened is the priests, Abathar was one of them, something with a Z was the other one. They took the ark, and they were going to take the ark along. This shows you David's heart. And David said, "No, leave the ark here." He said, "Who knows? Maybe this is something that God is doing. And I'm not going to try to gain an advantage. I'm not going to try to do something. Just leave the ark here and you remain here with the ark." And David left with his group. And they went down over the brook Kidron, I think it is, up over the Mount of Olives, and they headed east until they crossed the Jordan River. And they went over into what is today Jordan. And there We're in a city that I think is close to Amman today, I believe, if I'm right. And there they were. It is in that situation and in that difficulty. David was about 60 years old. It was in that situation, in that difficulty, David wrote this song. And out of that pain, if you could imagine how David must have been feeling, that he wrote this song. He had difficulty. He had trial. And how it must have been after having ruled the kingdom to have your own son. First of all, to have one killed, and then to have your own son rise up against you as Absalom did. And then the story, I'm not going to go on into the story of Absalom, but it's in this situation that David wrote this psalm. He was being tried. And as he writes this psalm, he says, Oh, I remember the times of worship and how pleasant your tabernacle, because the ark was back still in Jerusalem, and he longed for those times. This was his heart. He said, oh, for those times again when my heart's lifted up, when the worship is before you, in the pleasant times. And he went on down through here. And then he comes to verse 5 and verse 6. Blessed is the man, he said, whose strength is in thee. I see that all my strength is gone away. But blessed is the man whose strength rests in you, who passing through the valley of Baca make it a well, and the rain also filleth the pools. They go from strength to strength, every one of them in Zion appearing before God. And I want to talk about this a little bit, because when David left, he had to go through a valley. The way I understand this is that there was a valley that they had to go through that was called the Valley of Baca. The Valley of Baca was a dry valley. It was a valley that was hard. It was a valley where things seemed grim. It was a valley when things seemed hard. It was a valley that when you were in, it seemed maybe like a valley of death. A valley that was dusty and parched. A valley where hope seemed very small. But it says in this valley, there's people that go through this valley. It's also called the valley of weeping. The valley of crying, the valley of weeping, the valley where tears are shed. The valley of grief. The Valley of Baca. But when we go through this valley, it's necessary sometimes. Sometimes there's a season when there's a valley like that that we need to go through. The Valley of Weeping. But in that valley, it returns to us. And the tears fill up. And there's pools of water that later we can come back and we can find strength from and drink from. I've found it to be this way. That in some of the times when you seem so disoriented, so unsure and so uncertain, did I do the wrong thing? Will that mistake affect the rest of my life? Will that failure always haunt me? It's crying, it's tears. And your strength seems gone. It can be any number of things. Because we live in a life of perplexity. David resigned himself into the hands of God. He didn't try to take advantage. And he laid himself there in the hands of God. And he said, everyone who goes through this valley, or the people that go through this valley, they go from strength to strength. They've lived in one strength. They go through this valley of weeping. And they come out the other side of the valley, and they found another strength to walk in that they've never experienced before. Now, you would think that when you go through the valley of weeping and you find this strength that the Bible is talking about, that when you come out the other side, in the natural way of thinking, that we would feel, wow, now I'm strong. No, you feel weaker than ever. But in it, you find that the source of your strength is not yourself. It's not how wise you are. It's not how able you are. It's not how much you've even accomplished. But that the source of your strength is God Himself. And the more that your strength become shattered. This is not a popular gospel or message. We would rather improve ourselves to the point where we feel like now we can really do it. But this is the truth of God's work and God's life in our lives. The more His life expands in us, we come to places where our strength becomes shattered. And we weep and cry. It's real. It's not theory. We weep and cry. But in those times, my friends, if we allow it, and we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God, and we say, Lord, You look in me. You work Your life in me. You deal with whatever needs dealt with in me. And He reduces us and reduces us. And there we find His strength. And it is sufficient. More than sufficient. This is what Paul was talking about when he said, I besought the Lord because I have this thing, and whatever that was. And it's bothered me. But the Lord told me, He said, My grace is enough for you. And in fact, He said, My strength is made perfect in your weakness, not in your strength. Some of you think that you're failing because you're not strong enough. You may be failing because you're too strong. There's a wonderful place that we can come to where we lose hope in all of our ability. It's a wonderful place. When you've lost everything, you have no more to lose. You're a free man. Where you no longer have a reputation to maintain. And it's laid out. Where you cling alone, as the song says, nothing in my hand I bring, alone to your cross I cling. Where the foundation of your salvation is alone in Jesus Christ. And you rest alone in the finished work. And you've received, you accepted the fact that there's nothing in you, there's nothing in me that ever is good enough and can be made good enough to impress God. It's the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And as we cast ourselves upon Him, our strength fades. We find His strength to be enough to carry us. It's very real. trust Him for the situation that you're in today. Maybe you're weeping. Maybe you're in a valley of weeping. The Lord may be reducing you. Maybe that's what you need. There's other seasons, but there's times of reducing and refining. This is what David went through when he wrote this psalm. They go from strength to strength, every one of them a Zion appearing before God. Oh, I love what he says. A day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. I'd rather just be the man that opens the door and the others come in and out. Yes, maybe you see others that are walking seemingly in places of sunshine and places of grace, maybe that you're not experiencing right now. David said, you know what? I'd rather be back there and just open the door for those people to come in. I want to just be close to that than to dwell somewhere in tents of wickedness. Oh, David's heart and cry was, I want to be where the presence of God is. That's where I want to be. That was David's cry at that point in his life. And then God restored his kingdom to him. So you know the rest of the story. All right. I'm going to switch just a little bit. There's a verse in Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19 that says like this, if in this life only, because what I'm preaching about today, the title of my message is Lift Up the Hands, and it's about where you're looking and what your expectation is. What's your expectation out of life? And if you think that this life and being a Christian is somehow all of your fulfillment is only in this life, you're going to be very disappointed. Where are you looking and what are you expecting? Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 15, 19. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. What is that verse telling us? That verse is saying to us that Jesus came and provided salvation for us and brought grace to us and a finished work that our sins can be forgiven and washed away and that we can have a Holy Spirit in our life because that God is preparing a place for us because He loves us. And if you're only looking for this life to be satisfied in and that the things of God are only for this life, and you're looking for lots of money, a nice car, and a big house, and to be liked by everybody, that's not what it's about. And if you're only expecting things in this life, you're going to be miserable. But there is a message that the Bible teaches, and this is what I'm saying, it's from cover to cover, that the men of faith were looking, and they were looking out beyond their present circumstances, and they had faith that God loved them. They had faith that God was a place that was beyond what we're experiencing today. And it says in Hebrews that they looked for a city whose builder and maker was God, or is God, a continuing city. And as I understand what the Bible teaches and the New Testament teaches, that one of the things that you and I as Christians need to keep our gaze and focus on is, of course, Jesus. But part of that and part of the gospel is that this world is temporary. And our hopes should not be pinned on what we experience in this world. And when we pin our hopes on what happens here, we get disappointed. And that we should always remember that these things are temporary and that they are temporal. But that there is a place that God is making for His people. It's permanent. It's eternal. It's full of glory. It's full of light. It has no death. And Jesus is there, and He is the light of it, and God is there. And it's full of glory.
Amen.
This is the future of the Christian, of the believer. This is where we are headed. This is where we are going. If you're a believer, if you have salvation in your life, a lot of what we think of, and I understand that, but a lot of what we think of is, I need help right now. And God does help us. But sometimes we get so focused on, I'm in this trouble, that we forget to look and to remember who we really are. Talking about the men of faith. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off and were persuaded of them, and embraced them and confessed them, that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. I want to talk very briefly about strangers and pilgrims. They confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims. What's the difference between a stranger and a pilgrim? And what is it talking about here when it talks about strangers and pilgrims? A stranger is a stranger. When you see someone you don't know, it's like, I don't know that guy. He's a stranger. I've never seen him before. That's a stranger. When you travel to another country, they might all dress a certain way, they might all look a certain way, but you look different. You say, oh, where's that guy from? That's a stranger. He's not from here. Look at that, he doesn't act like we do. He doesn't look like we do. He talks different, talks funny. He's got an accent. He must be from Holmes County. That's a stranger. What's a pilgrim? There's a little difference between a stranger and a pilgrim. A pilgrim can also be a stranger. But a pilgrim is someone who's passing through. He's got a goal in mind. He might be in a foreign country. We've traveled to foreign countries. We've traveled to Honduras. We've traveled to Israel. Many of you have traveled to many different places in foreign countries. And when you're there, you know, you travel with a suitcase. You didn't take chest of drawers, and you didn't take everything in your garage, and you just put some things in a suitcase, and you travel through. You're a pilgrim, and you're just passing through. That's who we are in this world, church. We are strangers and we are pilgrims. And when we walk in faith and the faith of God and in the Scripture and what the Bible teaches us, we are strangers and pilgrims. And I'll tell you, young people, if you keep in mind the decisions that you see when we walk this way as a stranger and a pilgrim, we're strange and we're different because we have eternal life in us and we're citizens of another country. We've been impacted by faith. We've been impacted by the gospel. And we've been impacted by the life, the resurrection life of Jesus that is in us. And we're never going to be the same again. Because of that, we walk here among people whose hope is in this world. They look different than we do. They act different than we do. They get disappointed when their hopes are dashed because they're resting in everything in this world. We are not. We understand that this is just preparation for where we're going and that there's a place being prepared for us. Now, when we travel to another country, my wife and I are planning to do that this fall. When we travel to another country, we enjoy the sights, we enjoy the food, but we understand that we're just here for a little bit. We don't start building a house. We don't put our hope in that country. In fact, we don't even have the rights that those people do. Because we're not a citizen of that country. We're just traveling through. Understand this. We don't have the rights. Oh, we've got heavenly rights. We're pilgrims and strangers. Some of our trouble and our disappointment is because we don't live like that. because we don't live like them. We're pilgrims and strangers. And we're representatives of another country. The Bible says we're ambassadors for Christ. You see, when we live like this, we don't live by rules necessarily, but when we live like this, when we live with this mindset, it impacts our life. And when we go out in the decisions that we make, when we remember, you know what, I'm a stranger and a pilgrim. I don't really belong here. And we sense that. Sometimes we're among groups of people and they have their things. I sense that. I talked about conventions. I've gone to conventions. I've felt so lonely in groups of people, even people that I know, but I've felt so lonely because the things they talk about. Their language is different. Their language is different. I don't understand them. They don't understand me. If I would begin to talk to them about the joy of the Holy Ghost, they say, we don't understand your language. But I represent Christ. That's my call. That's your call. And so, young people, left and right, you know, we can set rules in front of you. Say, you can't do this and you can't do that. That's not what it's about. That's not what it's about. You belong to a heavenly country. And if you keep that in front of you, your goal is heaven. You see, sometimes we forget that. Your goal is heaven. And as you go to the store and you do the things that you do, if you remember, my goal is heaven. I belong to another kingdom. It will impact the decisions that you make. Absolutely, it will. It should. If you're a true believer, live that way. Live that way. How should we live? Abstain from fleshly lusts, it says, Peter says later on, that war against the soul, don't partake of that which makes you sick. See, we can make all of these things rules, but it's more than that. I was in Honduras once. Go through this very quickly, and then I'll be closing very soon. In fact, if the worship team would come up, I'll be closing shortly here. I went to Honduras once, and they told me, don't drink the water. You're not used to the water down there. Don't drink their water. It's got something in it. It can make you sick. So I was very careful not to drink the water. But I forgot that ice cubes are made of water. And I had some ice cubes in my orange juice. And it warred against my body. Not against my soul so much, but it warred against my body, and it made me sick, and I was not healthy. You see, there's things in this world that will war against your soul. Lusts. Is it a matter of don't do this and don't do that? Listen. There's things that if you partake of them, they will war against your soul and you won't be healthy spiritually. If you eat it, it will weaken you. You won't enjoy your spiritual life. You'll live under condemnation because you took something that is warring against you. Repent of those things and walk in the joy of salvation. Pilgrims and strangers in this country. We travel sometimes in sunny days when the path seems easy and pleasant, and other days when it's stark and dark and stormy and the road seems hard, but each step brings us closer. Yes. Here's a quote from somebody. I didn't come up with this, but I thought, wow, this is a good quote. Most people think they are in the land of the living, headed toward the land of the dead. The truth is, we are in the land of the dying, And we're headed toward the land of the living. That's the truth. You see, in today's age, for the last 100 years, modern medicine and science has made such advances that we don't face death like they did 100 years ago. And we get a little bit removed from it. But the truth is, no matter how far medicine advances and science advances, every person you see when you're out on your job and you're walking around in the grocery store, wherever you're doing, every person has a destination, an appointment with death. That's the reality, every one of you sitting under the sound of my voice this morning. And I'm not trying to scare you, I'm not trying to make you feel guilty. It's the reality and the truth. Every one of you that's sitting here today under the sound of my voice, unless Jesus returns, you have a destiny and a destination with death and an appointment with it. And I wonder, as we walk through our days and we see the people, are we impacted when we see the sinners, the worldly people, that they're headed towards a grave, and if they don't have Jesus, it's an eternal grave that is eternally lost? It's death. It's reality. And it's only the work of Jesus, the work of salvation, that makes you and I different from them. And the Bible says there's death, and after that it's one appointed once for man to die, and after that there is a judgment when we will appear before the judgment seat. But there's wonderful news. I'm not going to leave you on that note. There's wonderful news that the sting of death has been taken away, and the people who lived all their life in the fear of death, that the sting of death, which is sin, has been taken away, and we need not be afraid to die because of Jesus. Because of Jesus. I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. In past history, and I could go through all of this, I choose not to. Past history, there have been many, many people who have died because they have had faith in Jesus. They've been persecuted, they've been martyred. And they lost their lives, many of them in many horrible ways, from the early church, the Middle Ages, on even to today, 2015, or 16 today, but in 2015, according to what I read, there was probably more people that died in 2015 because they believed than maybe any other time in history. ISIS is slaughtering people, beheading people, Christians. And that's grim. And we don't know as far as our future, like I said, but we do know this, that the sting of death has been taken away. And that death, it need not be something that we are afraid of. And that we have a future that is tremendous and that is bright. The verse that is in the title of my message is "Lift up the hands." Because sometimes there's a tendency. I didn't even read that verse. I didn't go to that reference. But sometimes, because of the trials of life, sometimes because of mistake and failure, just because of trouble that's normal in life, sometimes our eyes, we want to go down, and our hands want to hang, and our knees want to shake. I know that. I know it's real. I'm not trying to diminish it. But the verses that precede that talk to us about someone who is a father to us, and it's God Himself. And the confidence that we can have is a confidence that there is one who sees where we are at and what we are in. And He says, even in those times and in those moments, just lift up those hands, because you have a Father. You have a Redeemer. And if you only have hope in this life, and if you're only looking for what am I getting tomorrow, maybe you can't lift up your hands. But look beyond that. Look to the reality and to the truth of the gospel and live your life in the strength of one who died for you day after day and moment after moment. Maybe you're, you know, I don't know. Maybe you're at a place where you wonder, will I ever get out of this season? Seasons come, seasons go. I've been in those places. It's a wonderful work that happens in those times if you allow it to. If you surrender and you trust. God bless you. Your future is tremendous and your future is bright.